Tin frames are very well known and commonly used in the early grades in elementary school, but did you know that they are a powerful tool no matter what grade level you teach in elementary? I'm Christina Tonnevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and today I'd like to address the power of tin frames throughout all of elementary in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our kiddos. Now, I am not a fan of directly teaching math strategies to solve problems to kiddos. Now, instead, we should be helping kids build their number sense in order to help them become flexible thinkers. Instead, if we just directly teach the strategies, they just become rule followers and they have more rules to follow and more strategies to try to remember. So my philosophy, and it's based on a lot of research that I can link up down below this video, is that when we build students' number sense, we build their flexibility with numbers. The byproduct of that is that they naturally develop strategies without us having to directly teach those strategies to them. Now, how we do that is a big, big topic, and my online courses, The Flexibility Formula, go in depth on that topic. But in this video, I'm going to give you one of my favorite ways. And one of my favorite ways is to ensure that your students have more than just a symbolic representation of numbers. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, if the only visual that they have of a number is just the symbol, like the digit, it becomes very hard to think flexibly about numbers. So kids need visuals of the quantities. And when they have those visuals, then they can group those quantities in ways that we are kind of trying to directly teach them with the strategies, but they can do it naturally on their own. So one of my favorite visuals to use is 10 frames, no matter what grade level you're working with. 10 frames help kids build their understanding of numbers, and it allows kids to be able to visualize those amounts so that then they can perform those operations we're trying to get them to perform. Now, typically, 10 frames are only used in the early grades, and the kids are shown exactly how to use the 10 frame to solve a particular problem. But I'd like to show you how kids can use 10 frames throughout all of elementary to help themselves develop their own strategies for addition and multiplication. Now, as I go forward with this, I want you to keep this in mind. I'll probably remind you of this towards the end, that just because we put a 10 frame in front of the kiddos doesn't automatically mean that kids are going to use strategies to solve problems. They might still count one by one by one, but when it's in a 10 frame, kids now have the opportunity to group quantities. So let's start off with single digit addition, and let's take a look at how kiddos might think about 8 plus 7 if they see 8 plus 7 in 10 frames. Typically, when we show 8 plus 7 in a 10 frame, it might look like this. Now I'm saying typically because this isn't the only way to show an amount in a 10 frame. I am just showing this one way as an example. But when we show it using a 10 frame, our textbooks often use the 10 frame to say, you need to make a 10. And typically they say, make a 10 by sliding some over to fill the 10 frame. Well, which 10 frame, right? Typically it'll tell kids, fill the one that has the less empty spots. So they'll move them over there. But it doesn't have to be this way. Right? There are lots of ways that kids might be able to determine the total quantity here, and it doesn't have to be the one way. For example, kids might want to make a 10, but they might want to move the 3 from the 8 over with that 7 and fill it the other way. That's totally fine. We might also get kids who do what I call finding the 5s. They see that the top row in each 10 frame is full, And they know that 2 fives make a 10, so they make a 10 that way. And then they just add in the 3 and the 2 extra from the bottom rows to make the 15 total. But some kids might not even want to make a 10. They might see it differently. Even in a 10 frame, kids will often still see doubles and doubles plus or minus 1. So in this one, we might have a kid who takes, like mentally, I'm showing it on the screen here visually, but they take 1 out of the 8, and now we have 7 and 7, and they know what 7 and 7 is, and then they can just add 1 more. You might get a kid who does it the other way, and they want to add 1 over there with the 7, and now they've got 8 and 8, and then they can take away 1, right? Again, these are just some examples. They are not the only ways kids will see them, and they're not the ways that we need to teach kids. When we show the visuals, kids naturally start to see these groupings. Okay, so let's take a look at multi-digit addition here. All right, 16 plus 28. If we have 10 frames that are showing 16 and 28, again, kids might see it in different ways. Here's just an example of a couple. They might take 2 from the 16 and move it over to make the 28 now a 30. That's a typical strategy that our textbooks try to directly teach to kids. But when they have the visuals in front of them, they might naturally do that on their own. Another one is to do it the other way, right? Instead of making the 28 a nice friendly number, they might want to move some over from the 28 and give it to the 16 so that now we've got 20, right? And then the 24 to put them together that way. Some kids might not even make a 10. They might want to group all the full 10s together first, right? Add your 10, add your 20, and then work on the ones, right? And then when they get to those two 10 frames showing the 6 and the 8, who knows how they'll put those together, right? It might be similar to the ways that we showed on the previous ones with single digit addition. Another typical strategy that textbooks will try to teach kids is to round up, like round one of those numbers to a friendly number. So instead of 16 plus 28, make it 16 plus 30 and then work from there. But a lot of kids get confused with that strategy. But instead, if those visuals are there, some kids might naturally want to add 2 into that other 10 frame to make it full. So they will naturally have the 30, and then they understand they need to subtract 2 because they were the ones that added that in. That was their idea to begin with, right? So, all right, one more. Let's take a look at how 10 frames might help kiddos with multiplication and developing strategies for single-digit multiplication, right? 8 times 6, first of all, it's helpful to think about it as 8 groups of 6. Now, in the United States, it is a convention that we say 8 groups of 6. Outside of the United States, you might say 8 times 6 in a different way, and 8 times 6 might bring up a different visual for you. Here in the United States, typically we say it as 8 groups of 6. So here is a visual that helps kids see the 8 and see the 6 without needing to count. When we put those groups into a 10 frame, I don't have to count to figure out how many groups there are. I know that that is 8 groups. And I can see that it's 6 because of the way that those dots are arranged. Now, how you arrange this might determine a certain way for kids to look at it. A typical way that kids naturally will see this without me having to point it out is that kids will see that that top row is completely full. And they will say that is 5 groups of 6. And a lot of kids know their times 5s. They know that 5 groups of 6 is 30. And then they can just do the 3 groups of 6. Right? Now, again, you might have kids who count every single one of those dots, but when it's in this 10 frame, it allows them the chance to see some groupings. But this isn't the only way they might see those groupings. There might be another way that they see it. Some kids might not like the way it's set up there, and they might visually do this little move. If you're looking away, come take a look at the screen here. So they might visually move one of those groups so that everything matches up. And now I have four groups of six and another four groups of six, right? That is a strategy that we want to help kids understand, is that if you know your times fours, that helps you with your times eights. It's like having four groups of something and then doubling it. That is a strategy that textbooks will often try to teach kids for multiplying by eight, right? But this, once we put it into a 10 frame, we can help kids be able to see those types of groupings. Now, another popular way for times eight is to make a connection to 10, right? If I have eight groups of something, how does that connect to 10 groups of something? And again, instead of trying to directly teach that, some kids will naturally want to do that. They will think, man, what if that 10 frame was full and we had 10 groups of six? I know 10 groups of six is 60, and that's a whole lot easier, right? So then where do I go from there? And that visual helps them understand that if they have 10 groups of six, now they have to come back and subtract two groups of six from that answer, right? Now, some kids might not want to break apart the eight groups of six. They might break apart what's in each group. Here's an example that I've heard kids say before, is that they see eight groups of five. They see the dot pattern for five in every one of those 10 frame slots. So they do eight groups of five, and then they do eight groups of one, which is to them, they are just like, oh, I just have to add eight. But technically, they are seeing eight groups of one, right? That's another way they might decompose that. And kids who are looking at breaking apart the amount in each group, I've seen this also, that they don't see the five, they see eight groups of three. So they see three, and then they double that because there's another group of three in every single one of those, right? So these visuals, they do not dictate a certain strategy, even a 10 frame. The 10 frame, there's no one right way to use it. They do not dictate a certain strategy. They allow students the opportunity to find their own way to group the quantities and allow them to develop their own strategy. As long as we step out of the way and let them, remember, our textbooks try to show us the way. I totally use air quotes if you're not watching that. Our textbooks show us the way to have kids use 10 frames, but there's no right way. 10 frames give kids a visual, and then it's up to them to figure out how many are being shown in a particular quantity. Just because I showed all of those strategies doesn't mean you need to directly teach your kids all of those strategies. Remember, all of those strategies were just possible ways that kids might see how to group those quantities and figure out the total for that particular problem. So if you liked this video, consider coming and registering for the Flexibility Formula. It's my online PD course that dives deep into how kids build strategies on their own instead of us directly teaching them those strategies. And one of the ways is to provide visuals that help kids develop their own way to see the solution to a problem. Right? And as I said, that's just one of the ways. The whole course is all about how we build flexibility in their thinking about numbers. So I hope that this video has helped you build your math mind so you can go build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.